Hi, I'm Mark Weissman, and welcome back to this deep dive on chi-squared students t and independence of sample mean and sample variance. And as I mentioned in the previous, this is video two. As I mentioned in the previous videos, this is adapted from problem 14-7 of Matthews and Walker. Their book on mathematical methods of physics. So in the last video, we derived the chi-squared distribution. And in this video, I want to analyze how IID Gaussian variables behave under an orthogonal transformation. And so let's say we have n quantities, x1, x2, xn, they're all IID normal variables with mean 0 and variance sigma squared. And so this means, this is the same thing as saying that the mean of xi, this is the way physicists write expectations, mean of xi equals 0, the mean of xi squared equals sigma squared, and the mean of xi, or the covariance of xi xj, is equal to 0 for I unequal to j. And let's say we have an orthogonal transformation defined by yi is equal to the sum over j of mij xj. So m, we'll have M being an orthogonal matrix, and to remind you, this means it satisfies M transpose M is equal to the identity matrix, which means M transpose is also the inverse of M. So for finite dimensions, that implies also M transpose is equal to the identity matrix, and in component form, this means the sum over J of M, JI, M, JK. Notice the transpose is implemented by flipping the indices here. This is equal to del IK. Del IK is the Kronecker delta symbol. It equals to 1 if I equals K, and it equals 0 for I unequal K. And we also have, that's that relationship, and the other relationship is on the other index. So that would be the sum over, and I'll screw this up, sum over I of M IJ M IK equal del IK also. Nope, that's not what I wanted to do. All right, screw that. I want to sum on the second index. MJI MKI is equal to del JK. Okay, so we could either sum on the first index and then we get the other two indices in a Kronecker delta, with sum on the second two indices and get the first indices in a Kronecker delta. So the first thing we want to do is to show that the yi have the same statistical properties as the xi. Namely, we're going to show that the expectations of the yi equals zero. The expectations of the variances of the yi squared is sigma squared, and the covariances are all zero. And this is really just a just plug in the definitions, so let's do it. The expectation of yi is equal to the expectation of the sum over j, mij, xj. Since these are constant, all these things are constants, we can take the sum out, we get the sum over j, or mij, times the expectation of xj, but the expectation of all the x's is zero. That was our assumption, so this is equal to zero, so that's good. Expectation of yi squared is equal to the sum over k of mik xk, so that's yi, and then we'll write yi again with a different index, sum over j of mij xj. This is equal to mik mij, this is a sum over j and k, times the expectation of xj. I wrote this wrong. Mik should be xk. Xk, xj. And this is equal to the sum over kj, mik, mij. And then this is sigma squared times del jk, del kj. Okay, and because if these two are equal, it's sigma squared. If they're not equal, it's zero. So that takes care of that. This is equal to sigma squared. And now, since this only, the sum over one of these indices, they have to be equal. So it's just, we can get rid of one index. The sum over k, mik, mik. This is equal to, using one of these things, here the k is the summation index, this is sigma squared sigma squared del ii, which is equal to sigma squared, since del ii is 1. I'm not using the Einstein summation convention here, so all my sums are shown explicitly. Now, finally, for the last one, yi, yj, equal to the expectation, the sum over k, mik, xk, that's the yi, sum, I'll use another index, the sum over m, mj, m, xm, this is equal to the sum over k and m, mik, mjm, times the expectation of xk, xm. This is equal to the sum over km, mik, mjm. It's going to be sigma squared delta km. Again, we can get rid of one index here. Sigma squared, sum over k, MIK MJK, which is equal to sigma squared, again using one of these identities, del IJ, but I is unequal to J, so this is equal to zero. So we've now established that these things have the right variances, means, and covariances, and I'm going to show that that shows independence. I know we've stated in class a lot of times that for Gaussian variables, if we show that the correlations vanish, then they're independent, but we've never really proven it, so I'll just give a brief outline proof. So to show independence, we need to show that the PDF for all the variables factorizes. That's the definition of independence. So we're given that yi, separate this, we're given that yi is equal to the sum over j, mij, xj. And we also have that f of x1, x2, dot, 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 xn. This is just a product of Gaussians because the x's are independent. IID, this is equal to the product from I equal 1 to n, 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi, e to the minus xi squared over 2 sigma squared. Remember, we're working with variables which have a mean of 0. Now, here's the trick. Since M is orthogonal, the Jacobian, which is defined as the determinant of the partial of the x variables, I'll use like these capital symbols to represent all the variables. This is equal to 1. And so how do we show that? Why is that obvious? Well, remember we have the M transpose M equal to I. So the determinant of M transpose M is equal to, remember the rule that the determinant of a product is the product of the determinants. So this is equal to the determinant of M transpose times the determinant of M, and we know that the determinant of M transpose is the same as the determinant of M times the determinant of M. So this is equal to the determinant of M squared. So, and the determinant of the identity matrix is 1. So we have, this implies that the absolute value of the determinant of M is equal to 1. And if you think about exactly, I wrote this, if you were, really doesn't make a difference whether we use M or M transpose or M inverse. We have like Y equal MX, that's our definition there. So that implies that x is equal to m inverse y, which is equal to m transpose, because m inverse is m transpose, so this is equal to m transpose y. And now if we were to take the derivative of x with respect to y, it's just m transpose. And the determinant of m is equal to 1, same thing to determinant. M transpose, absolute value is equal to 1. So now, let's just substitute. So f of y1, y2, dot, 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 yn, this is equal to, and we'll substitute it in this formula here. I'm going to rewrite, I should have rewritten this formula, but let me write it here, f x1 dot 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 xn is equal to the, if we would add up all these exponents, we'd just get the sum here. And so it's the same thing as a 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi to the n e to the minus 1 over 2 sigma squared. And then the sum of xi squareds, and we can write this as x transpose x. That's just the sum, the square, the sum of the squares of all the x's is just x transpose times x. So going back, we have fyi, so let's just substitute here. I'm going to get 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi to the n times e to the minus 1 over 2 sigma squared. Now x transpose, I have x equal that, so x transpose is equal to y transpose. M transpose transposes m. So this becomes y transpose m. And then I have x, which is m transpose y. But this is equal to 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi to the n e to the minus 1 over 2 sigma squareds. MM transposes the identity matrix, so that just becomes y transpose y. This is equal to 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi to the n e to the minus 1 over 2 sigma squared times the sum over I equal 1 to n of yi squared, which is equal to the product from I equal 1 to n, 1 over sigma times the square root of 2 pi, e to the minus 1 over 2 sigma squared, yi squared. And that's our factorization. So we've shown that the PDF of the y's factorizes, and so they're independent. Each yi is independent. And we'll stop here. It'll be the end of this video. The next video, we'll use this and establish that the sample mean and sample variance are independent. Thank you very much.